It's time for Cash Plays, where we turn bustos into robustos. Brought to you by StackEmCoaching.com. Rethink poker. And now, your hosts, John Kim and Joe Tehan.
Hey guys, welcome to Cash Plays, brought to you by StackEmCoaching.com, where we bring poker training to your pocket. Use promo code QuadJacks82 and receive a free trial. We recently increased our trial from 3 days to 7 days, so be sure to take advantage of the offer. 2+2 continues to be down, so for those looking to get feedback on hand history, be sure to check out our forums at StackEmCoaching.com.
Hey, what's up, guys? John Kim. Joe's having a little technical problem looking for his headset, like I told him here. I just want to say we're experimenting with Hemakuda. We're thinking of making it a three-way show, maybe making him some kind of a side host or a host, and Joe and I do the color commentary. So we want to see how that works out. That's why we have him on here today doing the intros. And we also don't have a guest schedule for today. We decided with the World Series of Poker around the corner, Hemakuda is like an intern. So we're going to grade him on his job today, whether we decide to can him or not. But we decided to go guestless today and talk about the upcoming World Series of Poker. I think there's a lot to discuss, and for people that come out for the World Series, we'll talk about cash games, tournaments, what CV, what isn't, which strip clubs you should go to, which is Rhinos, which strip clubs to avoid, which are pretty much none of them. I guess there's a few of them. Right, Joe? Well, Joe's not here to answer that. But anyways, we'll do some World Series coverage in the second half hour, and for the first half hour, we want to talk about, get right into, let's let Joe get situated here. Are you ready, JT?
Wow. Yeah, I was born ready, boys. Born ready.
Okay. All right, so let's get right into poker.
One of our coaches on StackEmCoaching.com, Dave Tannenhol, started a bankroll challenge, and he outlined the rules as following. Starting May 1st, he'll have a fictional bankroll of $0. He'll be starting at 1-2 and playing until his bankroll reaches $10,000. At the end of each month, he'll subtract $1,500 for expenses. When he reaches $10,000, he'll move up to 2-5, but he's only willing to lose two buy-ins before moving back down. Once he reaches $35,000, he'll move up to 5-10. Joe, what do you think the toughest part of this challenge is?
I think the toughest part is starting with $0.
He didn't mean that literally. He didn't mean that literally. He doesn't say how much he's starting with, but I assume it's kind of unlimited almost. I think he just expects to win from the get-go. That's why.
It's got to be...
let's just say it's probably about 20, 25 buy-ins, whatever that is, what, 5,000? Let's just assume 5,000.
Yeah, the toughest part is losing, I mean.
losing that initial row. I know Chris Ferguson, I don't like to talk about full tilt guys, but I know he did kind of like something similar where he started with no money on full tilt, ran it up to 10,000, but the hardest part for him was going from zero to $1, though. So he entered a bunch of free rolls. But this is a little different. It's a little easier since he actually has a working capital to begin with.
Yeah.
Right. Do you agree with his bankroll management here, JK? Would you be more or less aggressive than him?
No, I think it's fine. He's trying to win 10,000, so that would be 20, that's 50 buy-ins, right? Assuming starting stacks of 100 BBs. I think that's fine. He has to subtract 1,500 for expenses. Wow, I wish my monthly expenses was only 1,500.
I know.
That was 15 years ago for me. But so that's pretty reasonable, 1,500 monthly nut. I like the fact that he's including that because, let's face it, if you're playing poker for a living, there's a lot of outside costs that you have to be concerned about, and you just have to funnel your profits into. So this is what makes poker so hard. for a living is that it's not just about the money you win. It's about the money you actually get to keep and don't have to pay expenses with. Joe would tend to agree with that.
Yeah, I mean, it's tough. Like, you know, the more you win and the more expenses you have, it feels like the more things you got to pay for. You know, so it's never easy to keep up.
Yeah, I mean, the last 3-4 years, I've had my best years, yet I feel like all the cash is going out one place or another, whereas the first couple of years, over a decade ago, I was making 40 to 60K a year, and I had just seemed like I was wealthy beyond means, because it was only me and maybe Jeannie, and, you know, we're very thrifty, so.
But. Yeah, it's like when you first start winning at poker, it's like an amazing feeling. I mean, you got money in your pocket. It's like, you know, it's like $100 bills, and it's just like a different feeling, and you feel like you're just like the greatest, you know. And I mean, that's why there's so many young, like really arrogant kids in the poker world, but rightfully so. I mean, a lot of them are just killing it, you know. You got all the money, so.
Joe, did you have any struggles when you first came out to Vegas?
No, I mean, I kind of ran good from the get-go.
From the get-go? I mean,
like, I came out with, $6K, and I just played 20-40 or 30-60 limit hold'em, which was kind of like, I mean, I look back at it now, and it's like, wow, I was playing way bigger than I needed to, or than I should have been, but I just kind of ran it up in the beginning, and
so you had an really aggressive approach.
Yeah.
Much more aggressive than Dave's.
Yeah. I mean, I guess I played some 20-40 and some 30-60. You know, in the beginning, it was, I guess it was more so 20-40, like at the Mirage. I mean, this is 03, man. I'm like ancient now. So,
JK, did you have any hardships when you were maybe playing in college or up in Vancouver?
Not so much in college. I mean, you didn't really need much money, but obviously your first couple of years, I mean, I think I did pretty well. I don't want to say I ran good. I was probably the best player around town. Or I don't know, but I don't like to brag, but, no, I mean, I did okay. I didn't go through any struggles or whatnot. I mean, obviously I have had some spurts where I've struggled over the years. It's just part of variance, but I wasn't aggressive as Joe. I think I was in a budding relationship, close to marriage. So I was, you know, I heard a lot about bankroll management, and I applied that from the beginning. So I kind of like what Dave. I like what Dave's doing. He's kind of the pace he's moving at. He's not playing too high, and he's showing that once you can be profitable, even though it might be a little difficult making a living doing so with a 1500 overhead.
Yeah, that's pretty conservative, too, like only losing two buy-ins and then moving back down. I mean, that's kind of a conservative approach, but I mean...
Oh, yeah, I probably disagree with that. Two buy-ins is... Yeah, two buy-ins seems low. You can lose two buy-ins in 1 hour. So
I mean, two buy-ins is nothing, yeah.
Yeah, so does that mean if he's at 5-10, he's going to go back down to 2-5 if he loses two buy-ins in the first half hour?
Not sure. I think the hardest part of this challenge by far is going to be getting out of the 1-2 level. Because he's got to make 1500 just to break even, and I don't think that's including his food or any of his like entertainment expenses. But that's like, you know, he's got to win 10 buy-ins roughly and at the 1-2 level just to break even for the month. So I think he should be more aggressive in terms of trying to move up out of 1-2, because I just think it's hard to sustain a living at those stakes when you're only making 20-ish an hour.
The thing about 1-2 that a lot of people fall into this trap is they remember their sessions where they won $600, $500, $800 at 1-2, and they think they can keep doing that. Like, they just, you know, you hear some ridiculous numbers thrown around, like, yeah, I can make a living playing 1-2 or 2-5. You know, I've won 8,000 last month playing 1-2 or whatever.
Yeah.
And they think it'll just continue on like that. Not just 1-2, it's just anything in poker, where they run hot for a short amount of time, and they just think that's how it's going to be all the time. And then they face reality, usually sooner than later.
Yeah, so. I mean, it's the biggest thing that people hate to face in poker. I remember my cousin was asking me, you know, when I was playing some high stakes games. He's like, Joe, why don't you just go sit down and play in the small games and just win like $200 a day and then get out. Like, that's awesome. Like, you know, like, you can just beat the guys in the small games. Why do you even bother with the big game? You know, the big games. And it's just, obviously, for people who play poker, I mean, they know that it's just not like that. I mean, poker, no matter how good you get, it's simply a game of percentages, and there's only so much you can do. No matter how good you are, there's only so much you can do.
Yeah, so. And the thing is, people don't seem to understand win rates. Online players generally understand win rates because it's posted on PTR and stuff like that, and it's just there in your hold'em manager and poker tracker, so there's just no way denying it. But live players generally don't seem to understand win rates, what's like an average win rate, what's a good win rate. A couple of I'll use a couple of examples. Recently, I've been coaching a couple of people lately, and I told them, okay, at these stakes, 1-2, 2-5, you can expect to win 10 big blinds per hour if you're a very good player, which means, you know, at 1-2, it's about $20-$30 an hour. And they look at me like, that's it, you know. And these are players just coming up, like they haven't really experienced long run yet, and I think they remember the time they went $300-$400 in 4 or 5 hours, and well, that's like close to
$80 an hour.
Yeah, $80 an hour, $90 an hour, and they forget all those times when they'd lose $200, $100 here, $200 there. So yeah, they looked at me like, "Wow, that's it." Like, I mean, I'm sure their thought was like, "I could probably make close to $50 to $80 an hour playing 1-2," and people are just unrealistic with win rates. So
Dave's actually off to a pretty hot start in his challenge. He's up $1,100 already in just a couple sessions. So good luck to him. And here's a handy posted in the forums, playing 1-3. Under the gun limbs, we raised the $13 with ace, king of diamonds in middle position. The button calls, big blind calls, and under the gun calls. The flop is 10-6 deuce with two clubs. We have ace, king of diamonds, and it checks all the way through. Joe, how often would you c-bet this flop into three players?
Let's see. We raise ace, king. Okay, yeah, like, I probably wouldn't be c-betting this flop very often. I guess the only times I may be c-betting would be if there was one diamond on the board, I would probably bet the flop. With no diamonds, I'm just going to kind of check and hope to improve or you know, maybe take a free card and see what happens on the turn. There is a decent chance, you know, there's two people that check to us. There's a decent chance we have the best hand, but I would normally check here. I think four ways. Three ways I would bet, four ways I would check.
JK, do you have anything to add to that?
I think that's fine. I do think what Joe said, I'm saying it's fine. I do think you have to think about some backdoor draws equity. I think he doesn't say if there's a diamond on the flop. I think it's when it's close, you should probably c-bet if you think you can pick up more backdoor equity. Like if the flop had a diamond, so if you turn another diamond, you can keep barreling. But only when it's close and you're deciding whether to c-bet or not. But he doesn't say if there's a diamond on this flop. But I agree with Joe. There's too many players to barrel this hand through, especially on a 10-6 deuce, even though it's not that coordinated. But you got to think with 3-plus players, opponents, that one of them's going to hit something.
Are you, JK, are you checking with the intention of calling or checking with the intention of giving up?
No, I'm never check calling. Check calling, yeah. I think, would be pretty bad. I mean, you're pretty much turning your hand face up to what it is, like sevens or ace, king, high. And good players can exploit that. I know we're talking about 1-2, but
you see a lot of players do this where they'll check call. You know, they're, I mean, say there's like $25 in the pot, and the button bets like $12 or something, and now it's like call, and now the guy overcalls with ace king. Or you see a lot of amateurs do that, anyways. And it's really bad. It's bad. I mean, sometimes. There's a couple reasons why. The biggest reason is you're never going to win that big of a pot. I mean, unless you, whatever, go running straight or something like that people can't really put you on or something. But for the most part, you're not going to win that much of a, that big of a flop or that big of a pot. you're just kind of like hoping to turn an ace or a king and then hoping it's good. I mean, there's like so many things that have to go right there.
Not just that, but if you turn an ace or a king, I mean, look at your line. It just looks so weird. You check call, then what are you going to do when you hit top pair lead?
I would do.
But it just, that's if you check call. I think if you are going to check call, you should just lead the flop instead because you're pretty much risking the same amount. I mean, there's the only downside is somebody raises you and you have to fold. But I think that's a much superior play because you keep initiative, you keep your range wider. I actually think an alternative line, if you're going to check, is to maybe check raise. Say someone in late position decides to take a stab. Check raising, I think, isn't that bad. Actually, in some cases, it might be okay because you can still rip some pretty good hands by check raising a flop like that.
Okay.
Yeah. That's a good point. I never really do that. I don't check raise.
See, even Joe can learn a thing or two.
That's a good show. Point. I mean, I really don't do that very often. Unlike these total rainbow, much to those boards. I don't really check raise with overs there. Like, if I check, I'm giving up usually.
If a late guy bets, it doesn't even have to be a late position guy. Your hand just looks so strong, and it doesn't mean you can't have it. It just means, you decide to go for a check raise on the flop. Maybe you flop the set. Maybe you have kings, and you're hoping someone bets their 10. So you can still definitely rip some good hands. And you have six outs, which is pretty good. It's a much better hand to check raise with than, say, like 2 8s and 2 7s. So you can turn a lot of equity. You can turn an ace or a king. And you have the leverage of future bets that may get people to fold because you're the preflop raiser and you're showing so much strength. So I don't mind check raising the flop at all.
I've really almost eliminated check raising from, like, especially in heads up situations. I think the time I check raise the most is on the river. I really don't check raise the turn anymore because I'm always keeping the initiative. I'm always keeping my aggression. So I don't really check raise all that much anymore. I found poker to be a lot easier when you play that way. I don't know. Maybe it's just me, but I just found it to be a lot easier when you're just playing like very straightforward c-betting and like keeping the initiative when you have something, and then check folding when you don't have anything.
Yeah, I agree pretty much with most of that. But there's some spots you can check raise on the turn or river. I think stack sizes matter a lot. Say you bet 20 on the flop, one guy calls and he has like 140, and you just have some kind of draw on the turn. If you whiff, I think it's a decent spot to check shove all in, because if you check, he'll probably bet about 40, 50, and you can shove for 140, 150. So it's a pretty decent amount of equity. Or if he checks back, that's fine because you're getting a free card because you're on a draw anyways. So spots like that you can think about. There are spots that come up here and there. So I wouldn't always say just bet. But most of the time I would advocate that, just like you said, just to keep the game simpler. So.
Hey. Yeah, I mean, there are spots. I agree. But a lot of it is with stack sizes. For the most part, though, and like when you're very deep, it's just like bet when you have it, check when you don't. Like, I don't really get too tricky with check raising.
Okay.
So in this hand, it ends up checking all the way through. The board is 10-6 deuce. Again, we have ace, king, and now the turn is a 6 of hearts. So now the final board reads 10-6 deuce, 6. Big blind checks, under the gun checks. And the hero bets $20. What do you guys think about this bet here, JK?
There's 52, about 55 in the pot, and he bets 20. I don't know. I was hoping you'd ask Joe first because I don't know what to think about a $20 bet.
Oh, I think it's easy, and I think it's correct, and I like it a lot. I mean,
okay.
Yeah, I think it's an easy bet. And I think it's definitely correct. And you're not really trying to – it's not like you're really repping much. I mean, you're not repping anything really. But you're just kind of playing your hand for what it is. You have ace, king, high. No one bet the flop. And now it's check, check to you again on the turn. It's very unlikely anyone has a pair. People are just probably waiting to fold their hand. You know, they're just waiting for someone to throw a bet out there so they can fold. Like – So I wouldn't mind taking a small stab at it. And it's not even like you're taking a stab with, like, as a bluff. You're taking a stab. You're just betting $20 trying to protect your hand. I mean, it's – I think that's definitely
a good bet. So you're saying we're value betting our ace king?
I mean
– We have to be value betting our ace king. That's basically what it is. We're value betting or betting for protection. We're definitely not
like
bluffing
it.
With that. Okay. Betting for protection. Yeah, we are value betting in a way. We're, you know, trying to get – if people want to call it 8-9, 4-5, whatever, ace-queen, ace-jack, yeah, we're thinking, we're betting. So I think it's almost like a merge bet, a combination of reasons why. So a little bit on the value bet side, mostly for protection. So
do you prefer the bet here as opposed to a check? And what about the size, 20 into 52?
I like the sizing. I definitely like the sizing. There's no rule that says you have to bet half pot or more. Generally, that's the general rule of thumb, betting about half pot, two-thirds, three-quarters. But I think in certain spots, it's okay to think outside the box, bet less or over pot.
Yeah, it's all about what you're trying to accomplish. This was a hand I played yesterday. This is kind of interesting, but we played 5, 10, 15, three blind. So it was a straddle game, and everyone folds to me in the big blind, and I had 10 out there. So I have queen 8 offsuit. I throw out an extra nickel, and the guy who straddled now checks. And there's $35 in the pot. And the board comes, the flop comes 10, 10, 10. Okay, like this is a very, very basic hand. But now I have queen 8. The kid's kind of aggressive in the big blind. I think he would have raised an ace or a king. And the board comes 10, 10, 10, like, so I just throw out, like, a $10 bet. Like, I'm not really repping anything. I'm not, like, trying to make him believe I have a 10 or anything. I'm just trying to protect my queen high. Like, I think I have the best hand with queen high. I think it would have raised a better hand before that. And I don't have to bet, like, $35 to get him off, like, a 7-deuce offsuit or something, right? I mean, all it takes is, like, he might peel with 2-unders or something, but it's just like, what are you trying to accomplish? I'm not trying to get him to fold ace high or anything when the board comes 10, 10, 10. I'm just trying to protect my queen high. And the same thing here with ace king. No one bet. It looks like ace king's the best hand there. I say throw out a small bet and get him to fold their hands that can catch up on the river.
Okay, so we bet $20 in this situation, and now the button raises to 40. Joe, what do you think his raising range is here? What do you think he's repping by min-raising us to 40?
I mean, who knows? Like, right? I don't know. It's 10-6 deuce, two clubs, checked around. Now the turn's another 6.
Yeah.
I mean, what's he repping? Like,
he's repping a 6.
I don't really think he's repping a 6. Like, he could be repping, like, pocket 3s or...
I think he's more likely to have 3s, 4s, 5s.
I think he has like 3s, 4s, 5s.
I'm just saying, in general, like for an advanced player, the line he takes, it's supposed to be a 6. But we know he's not, that he doesn't have a 6. So,
I wouldn't be repping a 6. I don't think he has to rep a 6. Like, he's min-raising.
I don't think he's repping anything, to be honest. I think we can agree on that. This is 1-2 live. And we're not implying that most players are bad, or maybe we are, but I'm sure this guy has no idea what he's doing. So why would you check back the flop and then min-raise the turn when, like,
I don't think it's wrong, JK. The guy's got pocket 3s or something. That's what I would think. Right? Like, the guy's got 3s, 4s, or 5s. Like, he's like, oh, this guy's just taking a stab here with ace-king. I'm going to min-raise because I know I got him.
Because I know the actual result. That's why I'm saying it, but okay.
What would you do here, JK, facing a raise with ace-king high on 10-6, 2-6?
I think you have to call the raise, the min-raise. Because even if he has 2-3s, I mean, you have, you know, pretty good amount of outs. You have a 10 you can hit, so you have 9 outs.
Yeah,
going into the river. And also, he could just be doing it with, like, an ace-queen, ace-jack type of hand, too. So, I'd call.
Okay, so the hero calls in our hand. The river is a jack of spades, so the final board now reads 10-6 deuce, 6-jack, and we're left with ace-king high. Hero checks. and the button bets $40 into 132. What do you do here, Joe?
Call. I mean,
are yeah, you I guess we call. Because of ice, you're getting 3.5 to 1 almost.
Just because I wouldn't expect him to bet the river. I'd expect him to go check, check, and he's going to beat me with a small pair. Once he bets the river, he never has, like, it doesn't seem like he has a jack there. So it's just like he has a six or nothing. So the only hand I was afraid of on the turn would be threes, fours, or fives. So if I went check, check, I'd assume I was going to lose. But once he bets 40, it's like, what do you, he never really has anything that makes sense. Like, yeah, like all hands have to make sense, and his line doesn't really make sense at all. Unless, I don't think he would check a six on the flop after everyone checked to him. So the only thing that does make six is maybe, or the only thing that does make sense is like a random six, and I just don't think he has that very often.
JK, do you have any other thoughts?
No, I pretty much agree with Joe. I think the two big points we can take away from this hand is, first, the river. Yeah, like Joe said, if it doesn't make sense, if your opponent takes a line that doesn't make sense, tend to call. You're going to be more right than wrong. And yeah, exactly. Yeah, and well, I don't remember the second point, but yeah, that's one of the good points to take away from this hand.
Okay, so in our hand, we call. Button shows ace-x, and we show ace-king, and we scoop. So good result there.
Yeah, like I said, I just want to say, going back to this hand, I said, who knows what these guys are thinking? Sometimes they do such random stuff that you can't really. My point to Joe earlier was like, you can't really say he has pocket fours, pocket. I mean, logically, yes, we can, but sometimes it's just like a random FPS. These guys have no idea what they're doing.
With FPS,
fancy play syndrome.
Okay,
but they don't realize it's fancy play. They just think, I have nothing here. I'm just going to min raise and hope he folds, like, without giving much thought into it. And then, I mean, the turn, when he does that on the turn, but the river, I have no idea what his opponent
is. Yeah, the river, once he got called on the turn, he's like, oh man, maybe my ace high is no good here. Now I have to bet as a bluff. Like,
right. That's the whole thing. Like, why bet 40 into $130 two pot if you're going to bluff? I would bomb it. I'd bet like 150, or because we know Dave's range is capped to like whatever, like pocket sevens probably, like yeah. Sevens or ace king high. So yeah, I would definitely bomb the river if I was villain in this hand.
We'll be sure to have Dave back in the future if he reaches his goal of 10k profit at 1-2. Remember, you can watch and listen live every Wednesday at quadjacks.com at 3 p.m. Pacific. Come chat with us in real time and ask questions during the show. You can also view our show at StackEmCoaching.com, where you can download Cash Plays to your iPhone and Android devices. You can also email your questions to john@StackEmCoaching.com. Here's a listener email we received this week from Benny.
Just really quick, I told Benny I'd get to his hand because we didn't have time last week. So this is for you, Benny.
This hand took place in a $50 PokerStars tournament. We're the hero with about 70 big blinds at playing 125, 250, 30 with a 30 ante. Under the gun here, min raises to 500, and he has a 25 big blind stack. We have jacks under the gun plus one. Joe, what's your? Do you normally 3-bet in the spot? Do you just flat? What do you think here?
It's like either or. I don't mind. I don't mind either or. Calling or 3-betting. I don't know. It's kind of a whatever.
I think it depends on under the gun's opening range here. That's pretty much it.
Yeah, it depends on the under the gun opening range and how loosely he's willing to get it in against you. If you think he's might spaz out or something, and he's got like 30, 40 big blinds, like, or you know, even if he just had like 30 or 40, like 30 big blinds or 25. 35 big blind, somewhere around that range, I would always 3-bet and just get it in against him.
Okay, so he has 25 big blinds in this example, so you would just 3-bet? 3-bet
I would
call.
Probably 3-bet. Yeah, I don't mind. I don't mind getting it in, even though he is raising under the gun. I don't mind getting it with jacks again for 25 big blinds.
Yeah, the main reason is we have 70 big blinds. Even if we lose, we'll still have close to 50, which is definitely some enough to work with.
Yeah.
Okay. So we flat, and now the middle position, who also has a 70 big blind stack, 3-bets to 1750. Goes back to under the gun. He folds, and now it's back to us. Do we just flat again here, or is there any merit to 4-betting, Joe?
I mean, why do you keep asking me? These are tough, dude.
Because you're the...
Whatever, don't give me that.
You're the tournament.
That's bullshit. I don't know what the hell I would do.
You're the document player here, dude.
I'd probably call again. I don't think I'd back raise there, like... Again, it depends on his stack, how light he's 3-betting. Whatever. If it's an old knit that's 80 years old, I'd probably just fold jacks. Like, it's really hard to say. Those things are not, like, just easy to say, oh, yeah, I would do this, I would do that. A lot of those spots are kind of
do we have threes on these players? Okay, well, actually, I do have some reads. Under the gun hadn't played a hand, just because I want to be fair to Benny. I know he's listening to this or watching this. Under the gun was super tight, so this is why we decided not to 3-bet him. But the 3-better in this hand also 3-bet, got 4-bet. I guess he was 3-betting light. So those are the reads we have on the two opponents.
Even if the under the gun guy is really tight, I still think against a 25 big blind stack, I'm 3-betting and getting it in. Regardless of how tight he's been playing. I mean, don't you think so, JK? I mean, for 25 big blinds, I mean,
okay, I agree. I think flop,
you're gonna flop good. Like, let's say you flop 8-6 deuce, you're still gonna go broke. Like, I'm never looking for a reason to fold that hand.
I agree. I think based on stack sizes, and we just make the play based on the actual absolute strength of our hands, which is jacks. So
yeah, our hand's way too strong, and for 25 big blinds, that's about the limit against, especially against a very tight player. But anything more than 30, I would say, like, is fine to just call. But for that amount, it's a 3-bet.
Okay, so we end up flatting again, and we have jacks, and the flop comes jack, jack, deuce, rainbow. So we check in the hand. Joe, do you normally check here, or would you lead this flop?
I don't know. Like, so we flop quads. That's, I mean, doesn't seem like there's too many bad ways to play this one.
Oh, there's one bad way, open shoving. And, you know, we've all seen that before.
I mean, jack, jack, deuce, rainbow. Like,
this is just a check.
Yeah,
we have to check here.
Sometimes I would check. I mean, sometimes you could bet if you really think the guy's got like a big overpair. I think it's okay to just lead and start building a pot right there, because the guy's never gonna fold like an overpair to just one bet. He's never gonna fold anything to one bet there. I don't mind leading. But normally my standard play is a check when someone 3-bets behind me, so I'm normally going to check.
Yeah, well, we need a check to let him keep the lead. A lot of time he's going to have unpaired cards, and we just need to hope that he connects with those unpaired cards.
Yeah.
Okay, so the flop checks through. Turn is a 5 of hearts. Now it's jack, jack, deuce, 5, bringing the backdoor hearts. We check again, and the villain checks behind. Are you leading once the flop checks through here, Joe?
Yeah. Yeah, always. I mean, I would just hate for it to get checked twice. The guy could easily be playing pot control with aces and not want to give you... and not want to get blown off his hand, and doesn't care if he's giving you, like... Really, he's either way ahead or way behind with aces. Like, the most you ever have is 2 outs there, I would assume. So, if he is behind, so... I don't mind a check. So I would be betting. I'm sorry.
I like leading, too. I think you get called by ace-king, ace-queen sometimes, too. And I think he can have, like, some pocket pairs he's playing pot control on the flop with, too, that he's going to call two straights. So I'd probably lead.
Okay. So the river is a six of hearts, completing the backdoor hearts, and we just end up betting 4K into roughly a 4K pot. Final board is Jack Jack 2-5-6. JK, what do you think about the sizing and the lead on the river here?
I like it. I think you definitely have to bet here. So I think whatever. I think, yeah, 4K, that's fine, because he either has a hand he's going to call pretty much any bet size with, as long as it's not over pot, or just going to fold to any bet size. So like, it's pretty much inelastic, meaning you can bet any amount up to pot, and you should be getting the same result regardless of bet sizing. So I kind of like the big river bet.
Yeah, Joe, I think an important thing to talk about here, though, when we have like way, way, way the top of our range, this is really like an important concept. It is, when you have like a really big hand like this, you have to be, I would be so mad at myself if I played this hand this way, and I'd be like, where the hell is the rest of my pot? Like, you know, I would just be like, where the hell is the rest of it? I flop quads, and all I want is a 4K bet on the river. Like, I think when you have the top of your range like this, you have to do your own betting. So at some point, you just got to start building a pot. I mean, just hope you cooler someone. Like, when you have way the top of your range, you just have to start building pots and hope you get someone in a cooler situation. So this poor Jack-Jack deuce, I mean, he's not going to believe you if you ever bet that you actually have a jack, right? He's never folding any pocket pair, I mean, sevens through aces. Like, he's not folding anything, I don't think. So just start building pots.
There's a tendency, I don't want to... I mean, not with everybody, but some inexperienced players, when they flop huge, they're worried. And I hear this a lot because, again, I coach students, and they're afraid to bet with the nuts because they always say, like, everyone folds when I bet when I have the nuts. Because I think, again, it's being narrow-minded and just remembering what happened recently.
Yeah, they remember the times that people fold.
Right, when they have a big hand, they flop quad, they flop the nut flush, whatever. So they slow play it too much. I do agree, beginning type players and experienced players slow play their big hands way too much. They're fearful of people folding and not getting any action. So, but the whole point, would you rather make a mistake of picking up a couple of bets by slow playing, or mistake of, trying to be aggressive and win stacks, but instead they fold early on, whatever. I'd much rather err on the side of, trying to win a big pot, and then but instead they fold, versus, slow playing. And then, say, in this instance, for example, the river is a jack. That wouldn't be the case. Say the river is a five, and we bet the river, and he just calls, and he shows pocket deuces. Like, he was trying to slow play himself, right? So then we'd be very angry at ourselves, thinking, damn it, why didn't we bet on the flop or the turn? And we might have gotten stacks in before the river.
Yeah, so this reminds me of that the 7-8 hand that we talked about on the forums. A lot of the guys talked about this hand, but it was like a 5-6 way limp pot. The big blind makes a raise. Our villain calls in like the cutoff with 7-8. After a bunch of people, so it's like six-way action. The flop comes 5-6-9, and now goes lead. I don't know if people called or folded in between. It doesn't really matter. And now we call with 7-8, which I think is not very good. And now the button raises, luckily, to reopen the action. And now it's like, I don't know if everyone folded or whatever, but then like the villain just calls again, and now like we do all sorts of tricky stuff on the turn and river and trying to build a pot on the turn and river, where we could have easily just gotten in on the flop. Like, the button's usually raising like two pair or a set here, I would think. I mean, so just when you have the very top of your range, like, just get it in and hope you got the other guy in a cooler situation, which that 7-8 hand seemed like a perfect example.
Right. Just to clarify when I was saying, if the guy could have a big hand here, if the guy had pocket deuces here, not a deuce, Someone alluded to it in chat. The guy would get counterfeited if he had a hand like ace deuce or whatever. But I'm saying if the guy had pocket deuces, flop deuces full, and he's checking back for the same reason you're checking, to slow play and hoping the other guy catches up, and it comes running fives, it goes bet call on the river is probably the likely action. And so, whereas if he had bet earlier, there might have been a raise and a re-raise, and stacks would have been going in.
All right, let's move on from this one.
Joe, you played a hand earlier in the week. I think that was you found a creative way to pick up some Skolansky bucks. If you want to talk about it.
Oh, this wasn't my proudest moment. But... oh, actually, yeah, this one was great. We were playing the 5-10-15 again. About five or six people all limped for $15, and I'm in the big blind with ace king, and there's a straddler behind me. So I can either call five more or else raise. I mean, I always raise. I don't really care much about my position. I have ace king. I'm going to raise. And I made a big raise. I made it 170, which is enormous. But I don't care if I win it right there. If I get called, you know, whatever. I want to charge him for worse hands. So I made it 170. And now the straddler calls. Maybe one or two other people called. Everyone's pretty deep in this game. And now the small blind shoves for like 800, which I'm like, wow, that's actually a good result because I don't want to take ace king five-handed, you know, out of position in like a 1K pot. I'd rather get it in preflop. So now the small blind shoves, which was good for me. I reshoved for like 5K or like, I don't know, 3K effective. I think the deepest stack was 3K. So I reshoved 3K effective, and the guy who straddled called. And so we were in a three-way all-in pot. The small blind had four or five offsuit, which, you know, no comment, I guess. And the guy who straddled had two queens. And I had ace king off. And so I knew the guy who straddled. I guess this was one. This is like kind of a veteran move. When you spend enough time at a poker table, you learn to do things like this. But so now I'm in a flip pretty much against this. You know, I had ace king against the guy who straddled who had two queens. And we're all in for like $3,050 each. And the other guy was in between with like 800. So now, like, people don't realize that queens is way ahead of ace king. Like, people always say, oh, it's a flip. Like, equity wise, queens is like close to 57% against ace king. Like, depending on suits and whatnot, but it's like at least 56% favorite against ace king. So I mean, I had the ace king, and I offered the guy to my left. I'm like, well, why don't we save $1,000 on our flip, right? We'll only flip for $2,000 instead of flipping for $3,000. A, it reduces my variance, and B, I had a much worse hand, and I want to take some money back. So yeah, that's what we did. We saved $1,000 in the hand, and I ended up losing anyways. But so, I thought it was cool though. Like I saved $1,000, which means
you didn't save $1,000. Yeah, you're gonna say equity wise, right?
No. We saved $1,000. We said whoever wins the race gives the other guy $1,000 back. So we're only flipping for $2,000 instead of $3,000.
Right, but in theory, you're just saving the equity of the difference between the hands.
Yeah, but in theory, like, I'm picking up about 160
bucks.
That's
what I mean. Well, that's what I'm saying. That's what I'm saying. That's what you're winning.
I'm winning 120 bucks in Skolansky dollars, right. Assuming he's like 6%.
What I meant is you're actually winning in Skolansky dollars. A couple of things about your comments. You said way ahead or whatever. Queens is not way ahead. So
it is, though. It's
slightly ahead. You said
it is slightly ahead, though. But I mean, it's pretty significant. It's pretty significant.
It's not pretty significant. Come on,
56%. Like 50. It's almost 57%. Like
queens. Slightly ahead. It's just how we're not going to get into like language.
Okay.
But the other thing is, you didn't point out. I mean, whatever. I don't mind the way he played his queens, but You make it sound like you got it in bad. If anything, your play was standard. The other guy's call could be borderline questionable. You know what I mean? Because you're shoving, and he has to call off, whatever, 2K, 2,500, like 130, 150. I mean, if he's putting in 3K, he's calling off two. It was a straddle pot.
Someone asked me about the hand afterwards, and he called pretty quickly. And they said, oh, yeah, he beat you in the pot, blah, blah, blah. Like, it was a pretty easy call in his spot. And I'm like, and I asked him, I'm like, easy call. Like, I mean, how, it's never easy. Like, if I'm putting $3,000 in the pot with two queens preflop in a 5-10-15 game, like, it's never going to be that easy. Like,
was the straddle 15 or 30?
It's 15. 5-10.
Okay,
15.
So okay, the straddle was, yeah, he's putting in 200 BBs almost cold. Well, he put in 800, I guess.
Yeah, he's cold calling off like
800. He put in 170 and put in 2800 more cold, which is kind of crazy almost if you think about it. Because what's he hoping for? You have two jacks there. Most likely he's flipping against ace king, or you know, you're more likely to have kings or aces than jacks in that spot. I mean, I guess you can have jacks. You could even have tens, to be honest, but they don't really know that. So that's definitely not an easy call.
I don't think it's an easy call. Yeah, I mean, it's never that easy to get in $3,000. And it's like we said last week to Nick, no matter how good or bad or no matter how crazy the player is, like, he has just as good of a chance of picking up two aces as the next guy. So it's never that easy to get in 3K. Like, the guy's like, yeah, that was an easy call. I'm like, oh, like, or he didn't really say that, but someone else said that to me later on, and I'm like, well, that doesn't really make much sense. I don't see how it's that easy.
Yeah, I mean, we can just break it down. He has queens, and we just think about your range. Like, you have ace, king, kings, aces, more often than, say, like, I mean, I don't know. Maybe, I know you're going to do that with jacks and tens, I'm pretty sure. But I'm just saying most people might not think you're going to do that with jacks and tens. So most people are going to probably assign you to be more weighted towards aces or kings and then ace king. So like his overall equity is probably less than 50% against your shoving range there. So I think with the dead money in, it's probably a call, but I think it's a lot closer than that guy said, or you made it sound that initially, like saying queens is way ahead of ace king. So you kind of made it sound like you should be always calling there when in reality it's really close.
Well, yeah, that's why, you know, ace king's typically a lot easier to play than two queens are, because ace queen you don't mind, and even if you do get it in 43%, we just, you know, it's not that tough. Ace king's a lot easier to play than two queens, I think.
Okay. So. All right, well, we're going to move on to commercial. So we'll go to a quick commercial, and we'll come back and talk about the World Series of Poker.
It's time for Cash Plays, where we turn bustos into robustos. Brought to you by StackEmCoaching.com. Rethink poker. And now, your hosts, John Kim and Joe Tehan.
Hey guys, we're back, ready to talk some WSOP. Are you guys getting excited for the series?
Yeah, before we actually get into that, let me touch upon something really quick. A few episodes ago, I think we had Nick and Dave Tannenholtz on. We were talking about some angle shooting stuff, and we took it out of our forums. And the guy that posted it, really nice guy, I've met him a few times in real life. You know, he kind of brought up that particular angle. He was unsure if it was actually really angle shooting or not. We all agreed it was. And we said angle shooting is scummy or whatever. Just so he knows, we weren't directing that at him. We were just saying people that tend to angle shoot are scummy.
I just saw that. What hand were we talking about? I feel that was about sorry about that, Shaggy. Shaggy's like the coolest guy in our forums. I love his posts and everything. So
I wasn't gonna say names, but thanks, Joe.
All right, well, whatever. You know. We're all friends here.
That was not directed at you, dude. That was just in general that people that do angle shoot, we all agree they're scummy. But like I said, people haven't met you. I've met you several times, and I know for a fact I've come across a lot of poker players. You're not an angle shooter, and you're not scumming, and that's not
what. Hand, anyways. I want to.
I don't remember. It was like 3-4 episodes ago. So.
All right, all right. Well, I'm sure it wasn't any.
So I apologize if you felt like that way. Just wanted to let people know and our listeners know. So.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. Resume.
Yeah, let's talk about WSOP. My plan.
Yeah, what's your plans, Joe?
Just to win everything, right? That's always the plan.
well, let's talk about that really quickly. People go into the world, so this is, you know, for most poker players, especially professional poker players, but not even professionals, guys that play for fun, whatever, they make the trek out here. I live in Vegas, so I say out here. With high hopes, aspirations of winning the bracelet, becoming the next world champion. I mean, pretty much everybody comes into World Series of Poker thinking, this is my year, this is my time. I'm going to become famous. I'm going to go home a millionaire. I'm going to go home a champion. You know, everyone will get excited. But the reality of it is, it's a bunch of tournaments. There's super high variance in tournaments. Most people are going to come out of the World Series with less money than they came in with. That's just the reality of it. That's a fact. Would you not agree, Joe?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, for sure. I mean, probably 80% of the people are going to go in with or leave with less money than they went in with, I would assume, or somewhere around there. I just pulled that number out of my butt, but I mean, like, it's got to be somewhere. And not many people are going to win if you're just playing all tournaments.
I'm not trying to dampen the mood or, you know, the excitement people have going in. There's a reason to get excited. I'm excited too. And whatever. It's just it's the moment for poker players. That's what it is. The whole atmosphere and environment. For those that haven't been out here for the World Series, I would definitely advise, if you can't make it out this year, definitely come out here at least once in your life and experience it. Plus,
yeah, you can make every good decision, every right decision at every moment, play perfectly, and, you know, go 0-for whatever. And lose everything. People underestimate the amount of luck there is in poker. I mean, I've said that, like, I just really think that's the case so often. Like, people totally underestimate the amount of luck there is.
Yeah, I mean, we've talked to some very good players. I mean, some famous players. I'm not going to mention names, but, you know, I've heard some numbers thrown around 0-for-25, 0-for-30 during the summer, 0-for-32. And these guys are recognizable names. So anybody can just, you know, in the short term, and one summer is a short term. I don't know, was it last like a month and a half, 2 months, the World Series of Poker? Yeah, yeah. You could do absolutely nothing and lose like 100,000 in buy-ins. And there's people, very good players, that have done that. So, but on the flip side, it could turn a nobody into almost a household name, especially if you won the World Series main event or won two bracelets. You know, you become pretty much famous in poker.
Yeah.
JK, did you make your schedule for this year yet?
Actually, I was working on it last night, believe it or not. So I haven't decided. I am going to probably sell some pieces, but I haven't decided because, like I said, it's high variance and you need a pretty damn big bankroll. If you're playing in 100K worth of buy-ins, I mean, you probably need realistically a bankroll of at least $1 million to withstand the swings. Not many people have $1 million to play poker with. So
yeah, I mean, I'm gonna do the same thing. I'm selling pieces as well. I tend to do that. And I sell pieces and I also buy pieces, and it's simply for the reason.
Those interested, you guys can email Joe. He'll buy. He's on the lookout for pieces that he thinks is plus EV.
So oh, great. Not, yeah, I'm going to – my inbox is going to be flooded now. But no, I always buy pieces of people.
But, you know, that's touching up on a pretty important subject, is trying to spread your variance. This is why even winning players that can afford to like Joe can probably afford to play most of the events on his own, but he wants to spread the variance across numerous people. You know, like the more events that are involved across many players, the better the chance you're going to win because – you know, you're countering variance by volume. So, which is, you know, a smart thing to do during the World Series. This is why people buy pieces of many other people or swap pieces, stuff like that. It is very common at the World Series.
Yeah.
You guys have any tips for first-time WSOPers?
Oh, man. enjoy it. I think it's enjoy the experience. I mean, don't, you know, you don't want to get your hopes too high, but it's hard not to. It's hard not to, like we were talking about.
One thing I would say, don't be intimidated. There's a tendency, you can see it in their faces. I mean, people usually don't recognize me, but I mean, if there's someone really famous on my table, you can see they're starstruck by that person on the table, and they let the guy run over the table or whatever. Everyone's human, like all of us. Don't think, you know, if you're the hometown hero poker player, you know, you're good. Come on the tables. Don't think these guys that you've seen on TV are any much better than you. They might be, but don't get starstruck. Don't freeze up. They're nothing special, believe me. So
yeah, exactly. Just do what you know is best. Do play the way you played in your $100 home game, or your whatever it is. You know what I mean? If people win a satellite into like. Some guys only get one chance at this, like, you know, they get a one buy-in to a 1K World Series event, and that's the only chance they have at playing in the World Series. And they got 20 people that have 2% of them, and you know, it's like a big moment. You know, you can't make any excuses for the way you went bust, but you gotta play your cards. You know, if you think just go for it. You know, play the way you know how to play. And don't be afraid. Don't be afraid to make a play if you think it's right.
Yeah. Well, let's before you get into that, I wanted to ask Joe, what do you think is the best way, the usage of time at the World Series, if you're an all-around poker player, like playing tournaments, cash games?
Oh, no.
Are you going to say tournaments?
I mean, I'd probably say tournaments, yeah. Why would
I'm gonna disagree. We were just talking about how tournaments are high variance. If you're an all-around poker player and your EV is equally the same in cash game and tournaments, cash game is the way to go. There's kind of a misconception that cash games are softer during the World Series. In some ways it is, in some ways it's not. It depends on who you ask and what game stakes you're playing. I think the softest thing to play during the World Series of Poker, this is for people that are going to be coming here on a limited role, was that the wife walking behind behind Joe? Hi, Lisa. But people that come here with a limited bankroll, if you're equally skilled in all aspects of poker, or if you're looking for the biggest edge, I think sit and go is the way to go, especially down at the Rio. The like $50 to $500 buy and sit and goes, from what I hear, are very soft. I think they have to be the most EV usage of time if they're here at the World Series. So,
yeah,
that's what I would recommend if people are trying to build their role at the World Series. But obviously, if you want fame and glory, you have to play the World Series events.
I mean, I think if your EV is the same in a sit and go or in a tournament, I don't think it really matters. It doesn't matter at all. Like, theoretically, it doesn't matter, obviously. Like, it's just, but
it does matter.
No, of course it doesn't, JK. In a big multi-table tournament, it takes you a lot longer to, like, realize that EV. I mean,
But
in the theoretical long run, it's all going to be the same. But over the period of one summer, like, yeah, most people do want to reduce their variance, and just, I think most people do want to reduce their variance and play in, like, things that aren't going to be quite as swingy as multi-table tournaments.
Yeah, I mean, I should correct my wording. If your EV is theoretically the same across all forms of poker, then your EV is the same. But I'm just saying, I think your EV goes up when you're playing these sit and goes versus the multi-table tournaments. From what I hear, just how much softer the sit and goes are. It's because none of, like, the really top players play sit and goes. I've never played a sit and go, have you, Joe? But we still play all the 1Ks and 1500s. So
I don't play the St. Goes, but I hear they're great.
Well, that's exactly what I'm talking about. You're not going to find good players like you and other notables in these St. Goes. So that alone, for that fact alone, it makes them a little bit softer than even one case where you'll find players like you and other established players playing in them.
Yeah.
Here's a couple of questions. I'm going to jot it down. Are we going to be doing the doubles event? I don't even know what that is. What's the doubles event?
I heard about that.
Is that a tag team event? I have no idea what that means.
Yeah, I think it's an event where you switch in and out every once in a while, like every 30 minutes or something.
Like a WWE tag team match where they, you know... they slap each other's hands to come into the ring. Is that basically what it is?
Yeah.
So I guess if we're a team, I'll be coming in to save your ass a lot.
Yeah, we never really talked about this if we're going to be doing it together, but I think I'd probably rather play with my wife or someone than JK. I mean, I know plenty of beginning poker players that won't dust off a stack as quickly as JK would. So.
Yeah, sure. Okay. All right. And I noticed there's a couple of new – I was going through the schedule, doing my schedule last night. I don't know if you looked at it, Joe, but there's like a mixed match event. It's pretty cool. I can't remember the buy-in. It's 5K. I'm not sure if I'm going to play it because 5K events, I mean, you need a pretty big bankroll. But it's nine-handed day one, six-handed day two. Heads up day three, something like that, which seems pretty cool. There's also a four-handed event, which I was talking with a guy that backs people, and he says he's not backing anyone in the four-handed events because he thinks like nobody has enough experience playing four-handed events where they should have an edge on the field. And it's a $2,500 buy-in event, so it's not like a cheap event where you're going to have some random fish playing in it too. And obviously the usual 10K heads up event, stuff like that. Someone asked if any of us are going to play the 50K horse. I haven't played it. I'm not intending on playing it anytime soon unless I hit a lotto or something. Joe's actually played it once or twice.
I played it once. And I wouldn't play it again. I mean, the time I played it, I only put up 15K. And I mean, it's just too much money. too much money for one tournament, and I don't really. My ego's not that big that I want to like go out there and say, "Oh, look, I want or I'm the best, and I won this." Maybe when I was younger or something. I don't really care.
I think the field in that's pretty much stayed constant through the years. It's like the same 100 guys, 120 guys, right?
Yeah.
Do you feel that? It is plus EV, though, for a very good mixed game player. Because I heard many people say, it's actually, if you know what you're doing, then you're EV plus EV in that, even though it's a 50K buy-in.
Yeah, like, I feel like I'm definitely, I would be plus EV. Obviously, that's a super cocky thing to say, but, I mean, you're asking me my honest opinion. That's what I would, that's what I would say. But, I mean, if someone offered you to flip you a coin for... You know, they'll lay 105K to your, or they'll lay 55K to your 50K. Like, how many people are really going to do that? You know what I mean? Even if you think you have, like, a really good return in that event. A lot of those guys, you know, are just guys with money that like to play poker. It doesn't mean they're better or anything. But still, it's just a very big gamble, and I don't care to take it.
I remember I was there with you when you were buying in because I just wanted to see you buying into a $50,000 tournament. It's just kind of crazy when you think about it in relative to like the everyday person going out working annually for $50,000 a year. You're just plopping over $50,000. And I thought what was funny was here you are, you had like $30,000 in cash or $20,000 in cash bundled up, some 5K chips, a 10K chip.
Yeah,
some 1K chips, and you hand it over to the cashier, and she gives you back a little paper, and then says, "And here's your $10 food voucher."
Uh-huh.
I thought it was just so funny that you just gave her 50K, and you get this $10 food voucher, like, you know, $50K for that. I mean, where's my, you know, five-star suite? Where's the masseuse? All that stuff. That
I comes mean, seriously, that's what I was thinking.
I don't know. It just
and the juice, is, the juice was like $600 or $700 or something. It wasn't like, I think it was $600 in juice, or maybe even more. I'm not sure. But yeah, it's substantial. I mean,
So I guess that's a no-go for you for the $1 million buy-in event this year, Joe, the one-drop tournament?
Yeah. Yeah, no, thank you.
Yeah.
So.
All right. Any more advice, Joe or Hema? Hema, you were on the around the World Series last year, right?
Yep.
Was that 2 years? Last year the first year or 2 years?
No, what was it my like second year.
The first year? What was the experience like?
I just remember being super scared. I got to the Rio like That's 2 hours said, early.
Why are you scared? This is what I'm saying to people out there. Don't be scared.
It's tough though. Like it's like an emotion. You can't control it. It's just something that happens. When you see these people, you just assume they're better than you because you've seen them on TV or whatever. You assume that you're going to make mistakes and they're not. I just remember being really nervous, thinking I was somehow going to, like, I don't know, punt off my whole buy-in or whatever. That was what stood out to me, my first World Series.
Yeah, I remember the first event we ever played. You built up quite a stack. We went to dinner together and... you know, it was like a really emotional, like stressful experience for you. And I mean, believe me, for me too, it's like, don't get me wrong, I'm not like above this just because I've played a lot. Like, I still go through all the stress, all the everything. You know, I mean, when you're deep in a tournament, you go through the excitement, the stressfulness, everything. I mean, everyone does. It's, yeah, and if you say you don't, you're lying. I mean,
yeah, for me, whenever I get deep in a tournament, my mind starts racing. You know, you start to think about, like, what if I won this, or what if I got final tabled, or whatever. And you start thinking about all the things that go through your head, like how cool it would be to be on the final table, like what your friends and family would think, when really you haven't even cashed yet. And I didn't end up cashing in that first tournament, but all those thoughts are still going through my head. So
yeah,
I only have one thing to say. You have to live in the moment, live in the present. That's it. Just focus on your hand one at a time. And try to shut out all that other stuff. I know it's not easy, but whatever. But that's it, yeah. If you just focus on playing good, that's it. So,
yeah. All right.
Joe, do you hear JK or?
No, we lost him.
Yeah. All right. I think JK is still using AOL, so his internet might be might be done. But I can go ahead and take us out. So thanks for listening this week, guys. Be sure to follow us on Twitter. I'm at Hemakuda, at Nickelock Poker, and at Joe Tehan. And also, we've been giving out free poker advice on at Stack'em Coaching, so be sure to follow that. This has been Cash Plays at Quad Jacks, brought to you by StackEmCoaching.com. Poker training for your pocket.
Thanks, guys.
If there's something that bothers me, I write a thread about it. I don't know. It's news, views, and gossip. News, views, and gossip. News, views, and gossip.